talk, like walk the mic to them. Do you want to be my volunteer? Thank you. There's not very much of it, so don't worry. And it's very early in the talk, so your responsibilities will end and then you can leave or whatever. You can stay if you want. Self-organization, self-management, pair programming, mob programming. Some of you may have just been in that session. We're actively transforming the way developers and people in the entire world work. A study I found said that in the US anyway, over 50% of people are introverted. I tried very hard to find a stat on India. Unfortunately, I was not able to do that. Would you guys agree if I made the assertion, I couldn't find any data on this, but if I made the assertion that in technology workers, that number's probably higher? So is there a contradiction here? We're asking people to work in very collaborative ways, yet the majority of people who we are asking to do this are introverted. So does that make sense? Is that even gonna work? So this is kind of the topic I'm gonna be exploring today. Before I dive into this, I kind of want to explore this meaning of this word. What does it mean to be an introvert? So what I would like is everyone in this room who identifies as an introvert, please stand up. Whatever that means to you. All right, so, and I recognize maybe the, stay standing. Because one of you is going to get picked on, and I realize that asking an introvert to speak up in a big room like this may be a little bit futile, but would anyone like to volunteer to tell me and the room what it means for you to be an introvert? What does that mean? Any volunteers? So I've got a microphone, so.
Takes time to open up.
Takes time to open up, okay. Anyone else? We got someone back there. That's you. You're tired, you feel tired when you're with people. Okay. Kent?
She took mine.
Oh, okay. Anyone else?
Fear of being judged by others because I'm shy.
Fear of being judged because you're shy. Excellent. Thank you. Okay, you can sit down now. I won't pick on you anymore. Because I have my own mental model of what this means, and what I've typically in the past thought of this, I think of people who are shy, people who don't like people. Basically, they'd do whatever they could to be alone and not in groups, not really socializing. So this is one of the common definitions that I think was touched on. Myers-Briggs talks about where people get their energy. So extroverts get their energy by interacting in groups, doing a lot of socializing. Introverts get their energy by a lot of sort of quiet time, maybe still talking, but having more deep, interesting conversations. So something you should know about me is I feel fairly passionately about agile, collaboration. The teams I've worked with that I consider to be the most high-performing or effective teams are ones that they spend a lot of time communicating. They spent a lot of time syncing up and getting a shared mental model of the work they're doing. And anyone who's sort of attended Woody's session just now, he talked about mob programming, which is like an extreme version of this where people are working so collaboratively that everyone is working on the same thing at the same time. And I've seen teams work like this, and I've seen them be extremely productive. They can accomplish incredibly large amounts of work in short amounts of time. And I feel pretty strongly that this is a very, very effective way of working. But about 2 years ago, I started working with a new team, and what was drastically different with this team from the other ones, for instance, I was attending a stand-up, and there was 15 people on the team, and they organized themselves in a semicircle with the manager standing in the middle, and they would go one at a time and give their status update to the manager. So what's wrong with this situation? It's not the manager's meeting. Yeah, they're not really talking to each other, they're just talking to the manager. And in this context, this made a lot of sense because every single person in that room was working on a different thing. So why would they talk to each other? There's no need for this person to really be paying attention to what that person's working on because I'm not gonna be helping them anyway. So I'm a fixer. When I see problems, I wanna help people. I wanna help things make better. So I started getting on my high horse, my soapbox, and talking about these amazing collaborative teams I'd worked with. I was preaching to people about how awesome this could be. I started saying, well, what if we broke into two smaller teams? And what if we tried working on one thing rather than many things? How do you suspect they reacted to this? They said, yeah, okay, that's fine. Leave me alone, like, we actually like the way we're working. We know how to do this. We've been working this way a long time. And people started telling me on the team that actually lots of them identify very strongly as introverts. And they like quiet. They like being able to sit. They like being able to concentrate on the work they're doing without being interrupted. And they say that what you're describing sounds like a lot of noise, like a lot of chaos in the room, like I'm describing people at whiteboards, like actively talking to each other and having little side conversations. And to them, this sounds like a lot of noise and distraction. Has anyone here read PeopleWare? Familiar with it? So one of the things in there, he talks about this famous study, the coding war games. They showed that open offices, people were far less productive in noisy open office spaces. Not only that, people become sick, hostile, unmotivated, insecure. So the team started quoting these studies to me in a way to get me to shoo away and leave them alone. And one of the books multiple people on the team recommended to me was this book by Susan Cain. Is anyone familiar with this book? Naresh talked about it in his keynote last year. It's very famous, I think it's one of the most popular TED Talks now. And they're trying to get me to leave them alone, so they essentially like threw this book at me and said, go read this book and leave us alone. I don't think they actually expected me to read it. I was starting to realize I wasn't getting anywhere. I wasn't really able to influence these people. So maybe I realized if I'm really gonna be able to hope that they're gonna start hearing my ideas and the suggestions I have, that I need to take some time to understand where they're coming from. So I did pick this book up, and I opened the first page. If you haven't read this book, the first page is this bright red page with white text, and it says The Manifesto for Introverts. The hair in the back of my neck started like prickling up as soon as I saw this. And so if you haven't figured it out by now, I don't identify as an introvert, I identify as an extrovert, so I'm starting to think this is a bunch of hooey. And really, when is a manifesto ever convinced anyone of anything, right? So I start reading this book, and about the first third of the book, it's essentially making an argument in favor of introversion. And it starts painting a picture of introverts and extroverts that didn't really sit with me very well. So we've got extroverts are prone to risky reward-seeking behavior and lack impulse control. Okay, well that doesn't really feel very fair. Introverts, however, are slow and deliberate people. Extroverts are assertive and dominant and actually comfortable and maybe even prefer conflict, whereas introverts are sort of these deep, interesting conversations. Well, I mean, actually that doesn't really describe me, I don't think. I actually like having deep, interesting conversations with people. So extroverts have lots of superficial friendships. Introverts have small number of meaningful relationships. So I'm reading this book and I'm starting to picture it painting this caricature of an extrovert as this sort of oafish person who is sort of dominating everyone around them and not letting anyone else speak, and you know, they have this impulse control problem, so they just say the first thing that comes to their mind. Sorry, maybe that's too politically charged. At this point, I'm ready to just throw this book away because it's obviously a piece of garbage. Now, I'm gonna be honest, this is not the first time I've read a book that has evoked an extreme emotional reaction to me. The other times that I'd done that and I kept reading, I ended up learning something, gaining some new insight, some new piece of information. So this is actually a lesson a mentor of mine gave. Don't just read books that you agree with that reinforce your bias. Read things you disagree with. And in this case, it was actually really valuable. I pressed on, I kept reading, and I actually think that the second two-thirds of this book contains some really, really interesting insights into human personality and introversion, and so I'm gonna walk through some of the lessons and information I learned. So the first study that I came across that really started flipping the way I think about this concept was by Jerome Kagan. He is an eminent psychologist. His research has mainly been around the emotional and cognitive development of children. And one of the things he was trying to figure out was this sort of nature versus nurture issue. So are introverts born or are they made? So he did this study. He started out with infants. So he wanted to see at birth, are there differences in people's temperament? So he ran this study, and so infants were played tape recordings of voices, like loud voices, and balloons popping, and showed them colorful immobiles, and exposed them to like strong scents. And he wanted to see if there was differences in the way the infants would respond to this, so given this large group of infants. And what he found was there's actually wildly varying reactions to that stimuli. Different babies reacted very differently than other babies. About 20%, when they're exposed to stimulus, reacted expressively. So you could actually see them move their arms around more. Maybe their heart rate would increase, or their eyes would, maybe they'd look around. You could see a physical reaction to their change. So he called these high reactive infants. 40% were quiet and placid, so they didn't really respond at all. Maybe a little bit, but not really at all. And he called these low reactive. And then about 40% was somewhere in the middle. So already we're seeing that at birth, by the time you're born, there's already some temperament programmed into you. So he followed this. This is called a longitudinal study. So they follow the kids throughout their lives. And he did it at ages 4, 7, and 11. And actually, other researchers have taken this on. I think they're well into adulthood now. So there's, I haven't followed up on the research, but I'm sure there's even more interesting results. Okay. I don't know if you read that, but I was going to ask a question before you read that. How would you expect, so what are your guys' predictions? How would the low reactive babies, what personalities would you expect them to grow up into, and how would the high reactive babies, what would you expect their personalities to be? Any guesses? Okay, one person with a microphone, please. The low reactive or introverts, okay. And the high reactive ones, right, because the low reactive ones are the ones that aren't, they're not expressive, right? That's what I thought too, it's the exact opposite. The low reactive were more likely to have relaxed and confident personalities. These are personalities that you would associate with people who are more social. These relaxed, confident types, they're gonna be gregarious, they're gonna go out, they're comfortable speaking in front of people. The high reactive, the ones who reacted strongly to the stimulus, developed serious, careful personalities. So these are the ones who you would expect to be more reserved, to not want to be as around people as much. So this seems a bit backwards, right? So the other interesting thing is the high reactive kids seemed to be more empathic. So if they're around a friend who would be experiencing certain emotions, they would tend to experience those emotions along with their friend more strongly. Everyone's got some empathy, but these kids experienced empathy more strongly, and they would experience their environment more strongly. So this still seems a bit counterintuitive to me, but the next study, I think, helped me understand this a little bit better. So this gentleman ran an experiment. His hypothesis was that human beings seek to calibrate our environment so that we can be at an optimal level of arousal. So like our level of arousal is like our level of stimulation, how strong is our heartbeat, And so maybe if you're an introvert, you might not want to get up in a room full of this many people because that might not be an optimal level of arousal for you. So the experiment he ran, he took introverts and extroverts, a big group of them, and he gave them a very challenging, complex task to perform, and something that it was a, there was very easy to measure what their performance was on it. So it was it used a lot of high reasoning. He gave them headphones that were playing sort of loud beeping noises, and he allowed them to adjust the volume of the headphones to a volume to them that felt just right. And this is a very subjective thing. It's what does just right mean to you might be different than someone else. So based off of what we saw before, what would you predict would happen here? How would the introverts, what volume would they adjust it to relative to the extroverts? The introverts would be lower? Higher? Introverts were lower. Okay. So why did that happen? So they want a lower level of environmental stimulus to achieve optimal arousal. Does that make sense, right? Because if I'm an introvert, am I gonna go into a loud nightclub and be constantly socializing with a bunch of people? That's gonna be a lot of stimulation. No, I want lower stimulation to achieve optimal arousal or stimulation for me. So what was interesting is if they were allowed to control the level of volume or the level of stimulation, everyone performed equally well, introverts and extroverts. However, if you forced the introverts to listen to the sound at the volume that was optimal for the extroverts, they got worse. So they were at a higher level of arousal than was comfortable for them. So the extroverts, if you reverse it, you force the extroverts to be at the volume of the introverts, they performed worse as well, but not to the same degree. So think about this for a second. We are creating environments in our workplaces that may be optimal for extroverted people and forcing introverts to work in those environments. We may actually be forcing people to work in an environment that makes them perform in a worse way. So this is the first, and really this is what they were telling me, the people I'm working with. But it took me to read studies in a book to really believe it. But essentially what I'm starting to realize is that we can't expect every person, what works for me, what worked for those other teams, I can't sit here and preach to them what's best for them. We have to realize that different people have different needs and that there's an actual direct physiological reason for this. So this was a bit of a turning point for me while I was reading this book. So to understand why this happens, this is a very brief lesson on neuroscience. So there's two regions of the brain that can help you understand this. The first one's the limbic system. So this is where your amygdala is. This is your, like your center of emotion. This is the part of your brain that responds when you're under threat or fear. And the prefrontal cortex. This is the part of the brain that basically makes humans different from animals. This is where higher reasoning occurs. This is where complex thought occurs. This is what makes us intelligent beings. And the way they can tell what pieces of the brain do different things is they do what's called an fMRI. It's a functional magnetic resonance imaging. So they can put you in this machine and they can tell which areas of your brain are being activated given different stimulus. So if I lay you in the machine, I get you to do some complex task that requires high reasoning, your prefrontal cortex will get stimulated. If I put flash images in front of you that are going to cause you to feel like you're in danger, your limbic system is going to be activated. So the other interesting thing is if they do both at the same time, what do you think happens? If you think both would be activated. What actually happens is if I ask you to do a task that requires higher reasoning and then put you under threat, the prefrontal cortex shuts down. The blood actually moves from the front of your brain into the back of your brain. And people become measurably stupider. So there's another study showing basically that people do require some level of stress or stimulus. We can't just put people in a situation where they're not under some kind of stress. There is an actual optimal level that people want to get to. But if you push people over the level, they become, so with thinking about these open office plans, right? We've got open office plans and I'm sitting there and I'm trying to concentrate on my work. And there's a guy over here standing next to the photocopy machine screaming at it because it's not working, and another couple people are making like loud, noisy conversation. This is going to, especially if I'm an introvert, this is going to be perceived as like a threatening environment. So picture like we're back in the jungle or the savanna millions of years ago when our brains evolved. If there's a lot of threat around me, a lot of strange noises, I don't know what to make of it, is it gonna be evolutionary advantage for now my brain to be able to do calculus? No, I'm gonna be going into a state where I'm going to be heightened awareness so that I can flee danger. So I've talked about one aspect of introversion, and I've painted a picture that sort of is very definitive. You know, people who are high reactive babies become introverts, babies that are low reactive become extroverts. It's actually a lot more complicated than that, and even Kagan, the guy who did the original study, he wanted to assert in his work that there are multiple paths to the same personality traits, to the same behaviors, and the studies even show that the introversion extroversion is only about 40 to 50% inherited. So this paints part of the picture, but even this doesn't tell me of all you people that stood up and told me that you are introverts, that doesn't necessarily tell me exactly what kind of introvert you are. Maybe you are a high reactive, maybe you're not. Maybe some other thing can explain the reason that you identify that way. So the book actually, and I don't have time to go through in detail all the different studies, I actually encourage you to read the book. It exposes multiple different dimensions to this sort of concept of being an introvert. And I'll very quickly, one of them we already talked about was where do you get your energy? Another one was brought up in the front here about being shy. So it's interesting, somebody can be shy but get their energy from being around people. That might seem a little bit of a contradiction. Somebody might be very gregarious and spend a lot of time interacting with people and like that, but then they'll need to make sure they get time to recharge while they're alone. So these are not contradictions. There's actually, and I'll tell you in a second, I'm one of those types of people. I do need time to recharge, but people who know me would tell me that I'm fairly socially outgoing. One I talked about briefly was reward sensitivity. So do you have the type of personality where you're slow and deliberate and you'll go along, or do you have the tendency to seek impulses? So when I wake up in the morning, the first thing I do is check Facebook to see if anyone has commented. That is a impulse reward-seeking behavior that I'm sure I should not do. I talked about high reactivity versus low reactivity. Another one, self-monitoring. So do you adjust your behavior and personality based off of the people you are around? It's probably a big variety of people in this room on each side of that spectrum. What's really interesting about this one is they were doing a research study, and there was actually husbands and wives in this. In some cases, it resulted in divorce because so think about it. If I'm a high self-monitor, I'm going to think that people who don't calibrate their behavior based on the people they're around to be kind of selfish. But if I'm a low self-monitor, I might think that, well, I'm just being honest about who I am. And I might think they're liars. So they were finding that when they had people who were married that were on the opposite ends of the spectrum, it usually didn't end well. So I've done... how many of you have done the Myers-Briggs, just like an online test? Probably quite a few. It will give you your personality type, but a lot of the ones will actually tell you where you are in the spectrum. So when I do the Myers-Briggs, it tells me I'm very slightly extroverted. So even to say that like 50.7% of the population is introverted, that just tells you like where the mean is. It could be like that it's like a bell curve and there's very few people who are actually at the end of the spectrum. I haven't seen that data, but the average doesn't tell you very much. So for me, I just did quickly like In the book, there's actually like a whole bunch of like questionnaires that you can fill out, and it'll give you an idea like where you fit on these different spectrums. So if you take me, who like I was right down the middle, right? But if I break down for myself where I fit in each of these things, I'm actually like at opposite ends of the spectrum. So to say I'm an introvert or an extrovert, or to say I'm right in the middle, I'm actually not right in the middle. I'm actually at a lot of extremes based off of what type of individual like dimension of introversion or extroversion we're talking about. So this concept of personality is incredibly complicated. So even like when people are telling me, go read this book because I'm introverted, it doesn't really even tell me what they mean when they're telling me they're introverted. So I don't think it's really a helpful label in understanding people. So how many of you attended Woody's session just before this? Okay, so a few number. For those who haven't, Woody just did a session on mob programming. So this is this idea of the whole team works on the same computer at the same time in the same place. I first learned about this a couple years ago at the Big Agile conference in Washington. So Jason Kearney, who works at Hunter, so Hunter is where they pioneered this concept. He did an experience report talking about this way of working and what it meant to him. It was around this time I was reading this book, and I had this burning question in my mind while I'm, the whole time I'm listening to his talk, I can't wait to ask this question. I said, so like introverts must hate this, right? He said, well, we have a couple, and like they tell me that they wouldn't work in any other way. So that doesn't really, sort of everything I've just read about this says that that doesn't make any sense. The following year, this was Atlanta, the Big Agile Conference in Atlanta. This is Aaron Griffith. He also works at Hunter. He came back to the conference, and he did an experience report. He's an introvert who works on a mob, and he talked about why he works on a mob, why he likes working on a mob. He's one of these guys that said he would never work in any other way. Some things that I found very interesting from his paper and from his talk. One, he said it's not easy. He talked about the downsides for him as an introvert working in a mob. So he does need to recharge. You know, at the end of a day, he can feel quite taxed. Some of the things that he found that he really liked about mobbing was the fact that when you work with people all day, you can't help but get to know them and build strong relationships with them. And what he told me is that to him, and to, he said to, he was generalizing to introverts, relationships and loyalty are very important things. And as he, the longer he worked with a team, the stronger his relationships developed and the more that these people meant to him. And the other interesting thing that the guys at Hunter talk about a lot is respect and kindness. So they talk about this concept of safety. So if you went to the keynote this morning, he was talking a lot about safety. So on their teams, they focus a lot on having a safe environment. Last year, I was here in India. Richard Sheridan did a keynote talking about his company, Menlo. So at Menlo, they work in a big, so this is a picture of their office. It's this big open office plan. It's the big open office plans that people were said that are terrible and don't work, right? So everyone here works in pairs, so they do pair programming, and they swap their pairs every 5 days. So once again, like I had this same burning question. I'm like, I managed to corner Rich, and I asked him, like introverts, you mustn't have any introverts there. They hate this, right? He actually said, the vast majority of people that work here are introverted. He actually said he considers it almost a prerequisite to work at Menlo. So this is still a like massively it's totally contradicting the team I'm working with is telling me. How do these guys have this open office plan that should be triggering all of these like stresses in their brain and preventing them from being able to concentrate? It doesn't make any sense. So I, once again, wanted to dig deeper, so I had a Skype call with a few of the guys that work here, and I quizzed them a bit. And something I found really interesting is one of the pieces of language that one of the guys used. And he used this phrase, cultural expectation. He said, at Menlo, we have a cultural expectation of kindness, consideration, and respect. And this is pervasive across the company. Now, once again, he said, you know, there's downsides to this. Like, they feel drained working with people all day. They do need to recharge at the end of the day, don't really feel that social at the end of the day. They often get stretched outside of their comfort zones. But one thing he said, he's like, if I go talk to someone on another side of the company that I don't know that person very well, I know because we have a cultural expectation at Menlo that they will treat me with kindness, consideration, and respect. So there's a very strong sense of safety in their culture. Another interesting cultural expectation, if you ask for help, the person you ask for help will drop whatever they're doing and come help you. So you will always feel supported. You will never feel like you're not being helped out by your teammate and your community. Keynote this morning had this exact same slide, so I won't go over it in too much detail, but this is the Google study. It was trying to figure out what's unique about their high-performing teams. This concept of psychological safety, a sense of confidence that the team will not embarrass, reject, or punish someone for speaking up. We evolved as humans in communities. You take a human being, you put them in the wild, they're going to be under constant threat of survival. You put a group of people in a community, those people take care of you, they keep you safe. The blood can move out of that limbic system back into the prefrontal cortex. We are capable of doing great things as humans when we are in communities that take care, we're with people that take care of each other. So I have kind of one last thing I want to say about this book. It's very obvious to me that this book was not written for me. The sort of reaction I had while reading the first section of this book is not a reaction that introverts I talk to have. This book was written for people who have been told their whole lives that the way you are is not the way you should be. Society tells you you should be more gregarious, more outgoing. If you want to be a leader, you need to be a confident leader. You need to have more friends. I actually have a coworker I worked with, her daughter, had a bad grade on her report card because she didn't have enough friends in class. So this book is written to tell you that it's okay to be an introvert. It's okay to be who you are. You don't have to change. So when my team members handed me this book, what they were trying to tell me is, understand me. Listen to me. Don't try and change me. It's okay for me to be who I am, and I want you to be okay with who I am. This is a lesson I got from Esther Derby from a talk she gave a couple years ago. When I first started working with this team, I came in with all kinds of judgments about the way they should be and what was wrong with them. By the time I was finished reading this book, I realized that I needed to totally flip my approach. I needed to spend a lot more time understanding, listening, and getting to know who these people are. And I didn't convince them that they should all be working in mobs. I don't expect that they ever will be. By the time I had left this team, one of the team members had come to me and told me that she actually believed that they should all be doing pairing at least one day a week. She said, I cannot see us all doing pair programming 5 days a week, but she started to come to a belief that there was value in it and that they should be at least trying to do it some of the time. So to me, that was a pretty big coaching insight that I gained from this whole experience. It really changed the way I coach people, the way I lead people. And it gave me a lot of insight into personality. It helped me, if I go back to this whole, this is really far back. This one here gave me some interesting insights. One of them being maybe I need to reflect on my impulse control And maybe I need to not spend so much time thinking about my own needs and spend some more time trying to listen and understand the needs of the people around me. So that went a lot faster than when I rehearsed it back in my hotel room, so I have time for questions. Oh, what happened there? That's my kids. I don't know what happened. All right, any questions? Thank you for listening.